kapag mga free na yun.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Carmelita Nupi, the Executive Director of DAWN, and I will be your moderator for this afternoon. So today, we'll have the webinar one, the first part on webinar on mental health and psychosocial support and mindfulness as a form of stress management. So to formally start our program, I would like to call on Professor Aurora Habate de Dios, the President of the DAWN Board of Trustees and Senior Project Director of PAGI, to give us the welcome remarks. Oi, please.
Okay. Hello. Magandang hapon sa ating lahat. Okay, welcome to this first in a series of webinars that DAWN is conducting with the help of the British Embassy of Manila and with the participation of our experts, Dr. Jerry Risprudencia and Dr. Paz Manaligon. Welcome po sa lahat. I understand that we have followers coming from other countries and of course here in Metro Manila, meron tayong mga NGOs and a pleasant afternoon to everyone. As president of DAWN, Development Action for Women Network, siguro, kaunting introduction muna tungkol sa DAWN. DAWN has been around for almost 25 years na. And of course, we work with Mel even before that in many activities and projects regarding migration. Our common interest is migration. And of course, you know that we are a country that has always sent migrant workers abroad. In ang tansya nila is almost 100 or more than 100 countries, no? Any part of the world that you can imagine. Big cities, small islands, remote areas, may Pilipino. I can attest to that because in my work in the UN as well as in ASEAN, I've been to some places and in some islands that I never would have imagined would be accessible to Filipinos, ano, yung magugulat ka na lang, natatang, babatiin ka na, ah, kabayan, kumusta, ganyan, no? So it's wonderful to know that we are a very global people, but of course, part of the experience of being, going abroad and being a migrant also is not totally pleasant, and there are many, many, of course, negative experiences. So our object of inquiry this afternoon and in our series of webinars would be the migrant. And when we talk about migrant, any migrant at all, and specifically Filipino migrants, because we are the most global yata, no? Just in terms of the destination countries, we're talking of a person who would probably experience a lot of uncertainty. First, being a migrant, you're already a foreigner in a foreign culture, speaking a language that's different from theirs and not knowing the language or the culture even. And in many cases, our migrants, specifically women migrant workers, enter into the types of occupation that are quite, shall we say, vulnerable or even risky. So And on top of that, if they are undocumented, and even if they are documented, very often they're also not covered by labor laws, by the kind of the nature of the job that they do. So all of those things already present quite, a very shaky situation, particularly when their employer at home, no, kasi domestic workers na, are not so sympathetic or not so gentle with them, no, and very often they're quite hostile, and the experiences of violence that our women migrant workers have had to face, endure, and look forward to in doing their job has been well documented. So we're not talking of possibilities, but has already happened, and I've personally been visiting some embassies where that was the case. I have hundreds of complaints coming from our migrant women workers, and complaints of molestation, harassment, even rape. So for all these reasons, wala pa man yung pandemic, marami na silang kinakaharap na problema that will probably make them experience a lot of stress and a lot of psychological and physical insecurity. So comes now the pandemic, and the data that we have, and I've personally been also involved in training of government officials, the regional and LGU levels, and including the senior officials and diplomats of the DFA, their records show that the pandemic has really aggravated the situation of our migrant workers. First off, because of the immediate loss of jobs, no? And if before the jobs were not so stable, nowadays the loss of jobs is the real possibility. And thousands of our migrants have had to go home without the possibility of having to possibility of going back in their former jobs. So the second is because of the panic and because of the pandemic, many of our migrants have been given the least and the last attention by the receiving the destination country governments. Why? Because in the midst of a crisis, hindi mo unahin yung foreigner, no? Unahin mo yung mga citizens. And that's just exactly what happened. And many of our migrants have not been given the proper medical attention, including vaccination, to protect them from COVID. So that's a very, very real possibility, the physical and the health risk that they face on an everyday basis. Also, the kind of services that you would expect in a pandemic like that is not easily accessible. And for undocumented workers, talagang wala kang, they cannot even surface, ano? Because once they surface, they're already arrested and deported. So and on top of that, because people in the families are almost confined to their domestic spaces, the possibility of harassment, the possibility of violence against our women migrant workers is very high. And we have these reports that have been recorded by our embassies. And for all these reasons, the aggravation makes it such that na doble yung kanilang uncertainty, na doble yung kanilang psychological instability. But coming home is not, hindi ito bakasyon. Ano yung pag-uwi nila ay sometimes forced return. Again, faced with the possibility of not having any possibility of having a job waiting for them. So both ends, end to end, no? From the destination country to the origin country, pagbalik nila, the likelihood of, and the worry that they have is doubled kasi hindi na nila masusuportahan yung pamilya nila. And of course, they would think of themselves as a more of a burden rather than assistance to their families. So in these times, while already suffering physically and facing health risks, ngayon lang natin nare-realize, right? And I'm so happy that they've come to realize government, the NGOs, and Don in particular, have decided to pay attention to this very important dimension of our migrants' experiences upon return to the Philippines. That is the psychosocial support that they need and the stress management advice that they would be needing to face all these challenges and all these problems that are awaiting them or are they are already facing. So sa hapon hong ito ay makikinig tayo sa ating mga experts who will give us, you know, at least an overview of why people manage experience stress, how it can be managed, and how we can overcome these problems. And you know, in order to prepare us, in order to steal us from the problems that are yet to come, no? Aside from those that we are already experiencing. So, hindi ko na ho pakakatagalan at welcome sa lahat. I hope we have a very engaging afternoon. Thank you all for coming. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Oi. At ngayon po, I'll give a brief overview of our project and later on introduce our two experts for this afternoon. So the COVID-19 in the Philippines has been devastating for all sectors of society. No? Economic tensions, high unemployment, lack of access to social services, most importantly, it's toll on the mental health and well-being of people. This is most evident with women migrant returnees who have been repatriated in thousands last year until now. They are continuously coming back. Most of them return home distressed with little or no savings and no source of income. Although the government has been providing some programs and services to assist women migrant returnees, these interventions are not enough, especially in addressing their mental health and well-being. Because of the worsening COVID-19 situation in the Philippines for almost 2 years now, there is a need for continuous psychosocial and economic interventions. In this regard, Dawn, in partnership with the British Embassy Manila, is organizing follow-up webinars from November 2021 until January 2022. And this is the first webinar for this series of webinars. NGOs, including Dawn, play a crucial role in supporting the efforts of assisting migrant women returnees and members of their families. The project aims to fill in the gaps by providing psychosocial, access to services, and economic interventions, which will help them cope with their difficult situation. Today's webinar is on mental health and psychosocial support and mindfulness as a form of stress management. We will learn from our experts on coping strategies for the well-being of migrant women workers and migrant women returnees, as well as look into mindfulness as a form of stress management. We hope that we will learn more about new insights on coping during the pandemic, as well as practice these strategies for ourselves and our families. We look forward to a fruitful exchange of ideas with you during our open forum. So now let me introduce our two speakers for this afternoon's webinar. First, we have Dr. Jerry Jurisprudencia, a practicing licensed clinical psychologist and a registered guidance counselor. He is also an associate professor and a former chairperson of the Department of Psychology, the Miriam College. As an educator, he was a recipient of the President's Award for Teaching Excellence, the highest Miriam College Award in the tertiary level. He also received recognition from the Center for Educational Measurement and a very sought-after resource person. Dr. J was a board member, as a board of director of the Psychological Association of the Philippines for a couple of years. He obtained his PhD in clinical psychology from the Ateneo de Manila University and his Master of Science in Guidance and Counseling from the De La Salle University. Dr. J is also an advocate for women and children issues, a proud father of two daughters, and an internal migrant. I will introduce the second speaker, Dr. Maria Paz Agkawili Manaligod. She is a certified developmental psychologist and a registered guidance counselor and psychologist. Currently, she teaches psychology and guidance courses at Miriam College. She serves as department chairperson for the graduate school of the College of Education of Miriam College from 2010 to 2020. She was a board member, an executive secretary, and treasurer of the Psychological Association of the Philippines from 2010 to 2016. She was also president for academic affairs at the Colegio de San Lorenzo in Quezon City and also served as the vice president and a member of the board of trustees of the ADHD Society of the Philippines. She has published a book titled Educating Children with ADHD, The Philippine Experience. Dr. Paz received her doctoral degree in Child and Family Studies at Miriam College, Master's of Science in Educational Measurement and Evaluation at the De La Salle University, and also completed her Master's of Arts degree in Guidance and Counseling. She holds a bachelor's degree in psychology at the College of the Holy Spirit, Manila. So now, let us all welcome Dr. J for his presentation on coping and well-being of migrant women workers and migrant women returnees. Dr. J, please.
Thank you, Ma'am Mel, for the generous introduction. I just would like to check if I am coming in clear, loud and clear at your end.
Yes, Dr. J, very clear.
Thank you for that assurance. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Oyedi Dios, the president of DOAN, for the invite, as well as Ms. Mel Nuki, the executive director of DOAN, and also who are very aggressive in their efforts to really assist our migrant women workers. And this talakayan that we have this afternoon will not come into realization without the support of the British Embassy Manila. So I would like also to thank the people of the British Embassy Manila for sponsoring this talakayan. And above all, I would like also to thank the different stakeholders who are present right now. I know that you have the heart of the migrant women workers. And today, this is exactly what we will do, no? How to assist them. And if there are migrant women workers, we welcome them also to get involved and participate in this talakayan, because this is really all about them. But of course, for stakeholders, we are here to learn what new strategies perhaps we can use to also extend our assistance to our migrant women workers. So with that, okay, let me ask the, okay, so my slide here. So my slide is entitled Coping and Well-being of Migrant Women Workers and the Migrant Women Returnees. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so looks like just simply listening to the IATF that cases of COVID-19 are going down, but we are still not out of danger, okay, because everything is not back to normal yet, even if everybody seems to be eager to go back to their normal way of life. But I think we cannot go back to that kind of life, but perhaps to learn something from what is happening to us right now, most especially among the migrant women workers. So what do they have to be ready and be prepared? In spite the encouraging news, but one doctor friend I met just the other day said, well, everybody seems to go out and think everything is normal. They don't realize that we are still at high risk because there are still many Filipinos who are not vaccinated. So that is the danger, no? So we may be very much eager to go out, but these are people who are both vaccinated and not vaccinated. So once you allow this to mingle, the tendency of getting infected by the non-vaccinated might again be a very big risk. No? So it doesn't mean that just because we are vaccinated, we are not vulnerable. No? According to the doctors, we can still get infected. Kaya, I think this is the message of the Department of Health and the World Health Organization, that in spite of the fact that everybody seems to be eager, what should be at the back of each one of us, no? That we have to take into consideration. Una, that we have to reduce ourselves and reduce the vulnerability to the COVID-19. Okay, so yes, we know we are vaccinated, but still we might get infected, and we don't want to be the carriers of this virus to our family who were not vaccinated. So that's one. We have to be very careful of this. Second, we have also to reduce the chances that infection may still be real, and therefore, what controls do we do, no? Especially to our migrant women workers? So I know that many of our migrant women workers are really eager to go back to their workplaces, especially to destination countries. And the problem is, despite their being vaccinated, they are still discriminated because the type or brand of vaccination that the destination country they are going to don't acknowledge the kind of brand that was given to them while they are in the Philippines. So that becomes a problem. And so we heard that many of them still had to wait, no, for months before they get the clearance that everything is okay and that they are not carriers of this virus. And also, we have to be reminded that despite our being vaccinated, we still had to be conscious of protecting not only ourselves, but the people we are in contact with, okay? So, andyan pa rin, we still have to wear our face mask, our face shield, and wash our hands, no, with alcohol. These are things that we should not throw away, and that we should not let go of, no? Despite the fact that you are vaccinated, much more for our family members and those of the migrant women workers who are not vaccinated until now. So we have to be conscious of this. So this is now a part of the new normal that every one of us had to be aware of. Next slide, please. So ngayon, ano ang dapat natin tandaan, no? There are now many kababayan, migrant women workers, as I have said, who are eager to go back. Okay, and still those who are still coming in, they were stranded in countries of destination, and this is the only time that they were allowed to come back, no? Despite the fact that their contracts had expired. No? I know of one nurse friend sa Dubai, matagal na siya, tapos na ang contract, but because the Philippines also didn't welcome Filipinos from other countries, so they had to stay in the country of destination. And according to her, the sad part there was every day that they stay, they are being fined by the country of destination. So lahat na kanyang savings, which was supposed to be brought back home, were all spent without even touching base, no, in the Philippines. So that's the problem. So what are the other elements that makes our migrant women workers and migrant women returners vulnerable? Is the loss of economic resources. So instead of bringing money back home, they had to spend it in the country where they had overstayed. No? So instead of securing a future, they become more anxious. No? What kind of future would be waiting for them back in the Philippines, because their savings are depleted and they don't have pork once they are back in the Philippines. Also, another factor that may also aggravate the situation of our migrant women workers will be the distance of family members. No? So there are still many Filipinos who were not able to come back to the Philippines because of this pandemic. And that adds strain and pressure to many of them. Okay, so aside from the fact that their support is cut off, they also miss so much their loved ones. And another important factor that may also contribute to their vulnerability is the disruption of their relationship with friends. No, so they are not just simply cut off from their family and loved ones, but they were also cut off from their support system. Okay, and therefore this makes them more vulnerable to the external pressures. Next slide, please. So, ano pa ang nagdagdag sa mga pressure sa ating mga migrant women workers? No? So, those who are leaving the Philippines right now, okay, and those who are still in destination countries, perhaps maybe thinking similarly. No? And they are not just breadwinners, but they were also thinking of the different hats that they were wearing. Okay, hindi lang sila migrant women workers na nagsuspend ng time and spent money abroad, but they were thinking that they are the sole breadwinners of their family, and therefore the money that they earn has to be brought back to the Philippines. Another concern or distressing factor is that they are also worried. No, yes, you may be leaving the Philippines, especially for those who may be leaving our country for the first time, or even you left the country already several times. To be in another country is not something that is very easy. To be a transnational worker, especially if you are not a professional, may add distress. No, una, you are not even familiar with the culture of the country where you are going. No? The kind of language they are using, the kind of nuance that they have, dynamics of relationship. And this can make you vulnerable. No? And dagdag pa, lalo na pag dumating ka sa bansa where you are destined to go, your passport is confiscated, your cell phone is confiscated, your contract is not even shown to you, because for all you know, This is what they tell you. It's required that once you reach that country of destination, they should be the ones holding all these documents and taking all the security elements that are supposed to protect you makes you vulnerable. Wala kang passport, you cannot leave the area or the home. You cannot even call friends, okay? You have nobody to talk to because you are the only person in that region or place of the world. So to be a transnational is not very easy, okay? Much more, or if the kind of work, no, the nature of work you are doing can also add to the way they would treat you. Kahit nurse ka na, they still look down at you. How much more kung you are just a domestic worker? And so the more discrimination you experience. No? And added to that, okay, the other role is our migrant women workers are not simply women workers who are single, who are simply enjoying a trip, no? Vacationing. Many of them are mothers. Many of them are housewives. And therefore, to be a mother leaving a young child back home is a big pain, no, in the heart. Or a wife who may not even trust the husband back home. Okay, okay lang yan if she has the support of the husband. No, and the problem is most of the time, the distance can also add to the challenge in the relationship. And also, even if you are single migrant women worker, you still think of your family being a daughter, no? So, kahit lalaki man, being a son, you still think of how to help them even from a far place. So, this can add distress and pressure in your work as a migrant women worker. E kung ba, lalo na pag bumalik ka pa, okay, so you see your family back home. Bumalik ka nga, wala ka naman as a breadwinner. You had nothing to offer them. So nagdagdag ka pa. The reason why you left was to give food to the table. And here you are. You even add, no, to deplete the food on the table because you also had no work, no money to support your family. So these are elements that could add to the distress of our migrant women workers. Next slide, please. So, what are the impact of the pandemic to many of our migrant women workers and migrant women returnees? Okay, so one is the lifestyle is interrupted. So, kung noon masyadong marangya ang buhay ng mga pamilya, no? Because every month they would receive financial support. Now that will be a different story. Okay, the children cannot anymore be living in luxury. Work is interrupted. Okay, there is no more security of tenure because you cannot even go back to the country of destination. Okay, financial plans are interrupted. You wanted your family or your children to study in a good school. Some doctors, etc. But this time, no, that might not happen anymore because the migrant women returnee may not bring any financial aid to support the plans of the daughter because of the situation of the pandemic that we find ourselves right now. So future plans are interrupted, and this is what makes it more scary for many of our migrant women workers. So, kaya sa kabila ng pandemya, marami sa kanila ang talagang naghahanap ng paraan na lumabas, no? Just a week ago, you know, what a sad story. Even our professional nurses, 6,000 of them are leaving the country because now they couldn't support their families here in the Philippines because they couldn't get any support from government, etc. And therefore, they have to leave. And that will also burden our mental health system in the country. And that is just one. No? And therefore, this is really a big challenge, not only to the government, but to everybody, because we are all affected by this. Next slide, please. So, according to the International Labor Organization, no, of the 500,000 overseas Filipino workers, 44% of these are women. And of the 44% of women, 73% of these women are domestic workers. So you can just imagine, no, that these women migrant workers had to sacrifice themselves. Okay, they had to turn their back, no, from their families because they know there is no other way but to go out of the country because there is no work waiting for them here in the Philippines. And this is one sad reality that we have to face, even if we declared our overseas Filipino workers as the new bayani of the country because they just don't support their families, but the money that they send back home also supports the economy of the country. Actually, they were the ones who sustained the country for many decades. And without their financial remittances, I think our country could have been affected as well. But then it's a big, big sacrifice on their end to really do this kind of work, leaving not only their families, but the country as well. Next slide, please. So, ano ngayon ang laman ng utak ng ating mga migrant women workers in destination countries, or even if they are here back home? Usually, if you ask them, these are the things that they have in common. No? They are always worried and anxious about ano pa ang gagawin nila para mabayaran itong mga necessities sa buhay ng kanilang familia. No? So sila yung tagabayad ng ilaw, tagabayad ng tubig, tagabayad ng telepono, tagabayad ng internet. So whether you like it or not, it may sound very funny, but this is a very real situation. And we cannot simply ignore this because this is reality. Next slide, please. So what do we need? What do we have to do on our end as stakeholders, especially mga NGOs like DON? So we are happy that several NGOs or even our polo officers are really trying their best, no, to assist our migrant women workers. So anong gagawin natin para ipaghanda sila? No? Kasi ang paghahanda is the only key if you want our migrant women workers to succeed in the destination countries they find themselves in. No? So, ang pakikipagsapalaran will not be very easy without preparing yourself, whatever that be. No? Because if you don't prepare, no, by failing to prepare, you are actually preparing to fail. So, kung hindi ka naghanda, pinaghandaan, talagang expect na madali kang mawindang kung saan ka man. So this is the kind of thing that we have to put in our mind. No? Make this as our mindset, our attitude, that all migrant women workers had to be prepared, no? Because we cannot simply go to places without having some preparation. No? So just an example, our student teachers, before they go out and teach, there is what we call practice teaching. For the doctors, before they go out and heal, there is what we call residency. No, they had to spend another several years of paghandaan so that they can be prepared for any challenge and eventuality. No, even as psychologists had to have our practicum. So the same thing is true with our migrant women workers. It is not just bringing your body from one country to another, no? Uprooting yourself. It is not simply as that, simple as that. So what is the kind of preparation do we need? No? And what kind of preparation the NGOs had to prepare so that our migrant women workers, whether domestic workers or professionals, will really be ready in facing the kind of challenge that they will find in another country. Next slide, please. So what is the benefit and the danger once you leave the country? Okay, so there is what you call benefits and dangers. And allow me to say that the migrant women worker or the migrant women returnee, you know, their work is likened to a mountain climber. Okay, so what is a mountain climber? So just imagine, no? So you are trying to climb a place where you are not even familiar with. No? So mga mountain climbers, when they climb a mountain, they don't climb to a mountain that is already known to them. They would always go to a mountain that they are not familiar with. But before they do that, they had to be ready. So they had to bring their skills because they do not know what to expect. So just look at this picture, for example. Okay, the benefit is the exhilaration, the joy of succeeding once you reach the top. But the danger also is, what if your foot will slip? What if your hand is not able to hold on? So the danger of falling down, okay lang sana kung ang paglaglag mo is maikli, no? So, bali-bali lang ang buto mo. But if that will crush you, it will surely lead to your death. So, the same thing is true with our migrant women workers. When you go to a destination country, you are not sure what to expect. You are not sure. Yes, you know this is the country, the name of the place. But you are not sure how they would treat you, how they would deal with you, what is the environment. How do they treat foreigners like you? So that is something that you have to be at the lookout for, because that will not be provided, no? Okay, by simply giving you an orientation, unless you yourself will not prepare yourself. Katulad sa mga mountain climbers. So they had to practice, no? Climbing before they attempt to do the actual climbing. So the same is also true with migrant women workers. Next slide, please. So what is the secret of success? Ang sabi natin kanina, the key to success is preparation. This is the key that will open the door of opportunities. So kailangan paghandaan. Especially, many of our migrant women workers don't even plan to stay permanently in their destination country. Kunti lang na mga migrant women workers may think of staying abroad. But many of them, 70%, will be coming back. And so, we need these migrant women workers alive, because we know that the work is simply temporary. So it is not a lifetime opportunity. So they are also aging. They are also getting sick and vulnerable. Kaya now that they are still capable, what is it that we have to prepare them so that the opportunity that will also work back in their benefit? Next slide, please. So what is to prepare in order to be fit? So just to remind our migrant women workers, and especially those stakeholders, how do you prepare our migrant women workers? So it is physical preparation. So sabi natin, my medical certificate. But minsan, the medical certificate may not be, what you call this, covering the whole duration of their stay in the destination country. What may be reflected there might be the temporary situation when they apply. So it is still very important that they had to be physically healthy, emotional, because they are leaving their families and their loved ones. How prepared are they? Makikita naman natin yan sa airport, no? Iyakan galore pag umalis na yung mga mahal sa buhay. So makikita nyo na pag if the migrant women workers are not emotionally ready to leave, sometimes they will bring that emptiness with them in the destination country. Intellectual, they had to be prepared because they may not know the language, so they had to be intellectually ready, no? Pag-aralan ang kinagawian ng mga tao doon, pag-aralan ang lingwahe, pag-aralan ang pakikitungo. So you have to be intellectually prepared for this. Socially, so if you are alone, what is expected from you? Will you simply withdraw yourself? So you have also to ready yourself that even if I am alone, I should reach out. I should connect not only with the people that I will be working with, but I will also be connecting with my fellow Filipino workers who may be in the same area that they may be working. And financially, how prepared will you be? Sad to say, many of our migrant women workers are in debt, no? Nangutang yan para lumabas ng bansa with the dream that once they are back home a year or two later, they will pay back the debt that they owed somebody. No? I have a friend, nag-resign siya, okay, from a very good, a stable job, thinking na by going to Saudi Arabia for a year, he will be gaining double the salary that he's earning here in the Philippines. And after three months, he came back to the Philippines and he was not able to pay the debt that they owed a relative. No? So it may not be an assurance right away that leaving the country will lift you up, no? And give you that future that you expect. So what kind of financial preparation do you need? Because remember, you may not be in the destination country for the rest of your life. Okay, so you cannot simply splurge, no? What kind of preparation do you need environmentally? Okay, because that place may be too hot for you. You may not be climatized, okay? So these are the different kinds of preparation that we have to inculcate to our migrant women workers before they leave the country. Next slide, please. And what are these preparation? Actually, this is the summary of what we call mental health. If you look at the World Health Organization framework, no, the wellness wheel, lahat na sinabi ko na dapat paggandaan ng isang manggagawa were all mentioned and identified in the wellness wheel. Okay, so your mental health is actually a summary of all those preparation. And what is beautiful here is that mental health is also equated to the term well-being. It is a state of well-being. Ito ang kalusugan, pangkalahatan. See, ito ang sa Tagalog sa atin, no? Or hindi lang kalusugan pangkaisipan, but kalusugan pangkalahatan. kasi you are not just simply referring to the physical health, but you're also referring to the other aspects that can affect your health. And we call this well-being. Next slide, please. So, what is well-being? So, saan kinukuha ng migrant women returnee or migrant women worker ang lakas ng loob, ang hugot? Okay? So, ang lakas ng isang migrant women worker, okay, is from her well-being or mental health. Kung may well-being siya, okay, that will sustain and support not only her stay in the destination country, but it will also support her and her family even when she is back to the home country. Maganda dito ang Pilipino na equivalent ng well-being, no? If you look at the word well-being, it is also the same as being well. Okay? At kung i-translate natin ito ang well, hindi ba sa Tagalog, hindi lang ito nagkakahulugan ng wala kang sakit. It also means magaling or gumaling, no? And pag sinabi mong well, another meaning of well is balloon, no? So ang balloon sa atin mga Pinoy is nagbibigay siya ng source ng buhay kasi doon natin kinukuha ang tubig. Kaya pag sinabi mong well, ano ang translation nito sa Pinoy? Magaling, no? So kasi well is galing, no? Kung sa another well, hindi lang balloon, galing din, no? Kaya ang word na magaling is also taken from the word well. Okay? So kung magaling ka, mahusay ka. Or kung may galing, maabilidad ka, you are resourceful, no? Or kung galing lang, you are competent. Kaya pag sinabi mong well-being, dala mo ang balon ng kagalingan. So wherever you are, always have that mindset na dito yan sa akin, dito ko kinukuha ang lakas ng loob, ang hugot para, no, ipakita ko kahit saan ako na magaling ako bilang isang migrant women worker. O may galing ako, may kahusayan ako, no, may abilidad. Kaya you are a work in progress, no, being well. Next slide, please. So, ano ang lakas ng migrant women worker? This is very ironical kasi ang lakas ng migrant women worker at ng migrant women returnees are also their kahinaan, no? Saan sila malakas? Kasi ang nagbibigay lakas sa kanila ay ang kanilang pamilya. Ang nagbibigay lakas sa kanila ay kanilang relasyon sa kapwa, no, social network with friends. Ang nagbibigay ng lakas sa kanila ay job security. But the same elements can also be their kahinaan, their Achilles heel. Kasi kung may mangyari sa kanilang pamilya back home, that will also drain them. Kung may mangyari sa kanilang relasyon sa mga kaibigan, kung may problema sila at nag-iisa sila, that can also bring them at risk. At kung mawala sila ng trabaho kasi pinalaya sila o pinaalis, no, ng kanilang employer, that will also put them at risk and put them in danger. So, dapat tandaan ng ating mga migrant women workers, what your strengths are will also be your weaknesses. Therefore, you have to take this into consideration so that they will not make you vulnerable. Next slide, please. So, let us define what is stress. No? So, according to kay Hans Selye, si Hans Selye is the person who coined the word stress. Okay, any movement, any change in the physical, in the mental, or the emotional aspect in the person's life or in the life of the migrant women worker can bring strain or pressure. Okay, lalo na pag ang kanyang social resources are not enough to face the demands of the strain. No, okay lang yan kung pareho ang kanyang resources with the demands, then she is able to survive. But if the demands exceeds her human resources to cope, then that will make our migrant women worker vulnerable. Next slide, please. So, tandaan natin, ha? So kung ang stress is defined as the strain or the pressure, ano naman ang stressor? Ang stressor is the one that triggers the stress. Na dalawa ang papanggalingan ng stressor that triggers the stress. It can be internal stressor or it can be an external stressor. So ang internal stressor ng migrant women worker, ang kanyang paniniwala sa sarili, no? Ang kanyang values, ang kanyang pag-interpret sa kanyang paligid. So kung wala siyang balon ng kagalingan, ang tingin niya sa sarili niya ay hindi siya maabilidad. Sa tingin niya sa sarili, wala siyang ipapakitang galing or kahusayan. Madali siya ma-overwhelmed ng stressor, especially if the stressor in the destination country exceeds her internal resources. Now, ang external stressor might be the work. No? Kahit na maglinis ka ng tatlong palapag ng building, that is an external stressor. I heard of one Filipino migrant worker. 4 stories ang building ng kanyang Arabo na amo. At wala pang elevator. So she would start cleaning the ground floor from 4 o'clock in the morning at matapos siya 11 o'clock at night. So imagine. So external stressor yan. But because ang lakas ng kanyang internal stressor, ang lakas ng kanyang hugot, kasi ginagawa ko ito para sa aking mahal sa buhay, so hindi siya nawindang, no? Despite the external demands. Pero kung may nangyari sa pamilya sa Pilipinas, dagdagan pa ng external stressor, then that becomes a distress. Okay? Because stress can also be healthy. So as what I have said, no, she made that work healthy for her. So it sustained her to work. Even she was able to stay there for 3 years. No? But if the internal stressor is already getting depleted, so the external stressor can be demanding as well. And everything may look distressing for the migrant women worker. So you have to look at the situation. For some migrant women workers, what made them stay? Because they look at the stress as a healthy stress. No? But if it becomes unhealthy and distressed, katulad sa isang just a week ago, okay, nagreklamo siya because hindi siya sinasahuran ng isang Arabo ng regularly, imagine for almost 6 months. Okay, so mabuti nakatawag siya sa kaibigan, pinalipat siya ng employer. And then ang second employer naman, she was raped by the male Arab employer. So that is a very sad story, no? She was able to survive one external stressor, but she succumbed to another external stressor. Okay, and therefore, she was really, kahit sa wala na lang trabaho, basta makauwi na lang ng Pilipinas. So this can happen, no? Kaya, as I have said, ano ang lalim ng balon ng kagalingan ng isang migrant women worker before she leaves her home country? This is very important because it can dictate or impact how he or she will be performing in a destination country. Next slide, please. So these are the main stressors that our migrant women workers may be faced with. So external stressors, mga ang country, no, the culture, the people, the language. Okay, internal stressors, anong paniwala mo sa sarili, no? Ano ang values mo that gives you strength? Ano ang developmental stressors? Tumatanda ka rin, you are not always young. Makaramdam ka rin ng sakit, napapagod ka, that is developmental stressor. Anong occupational stressor? Binibigyan ka ba ng sahod regularly? Or minsan, hindi na. So, is there waiting for you? Or kailangan mo ba bumalik ng Pilipinas? Situational stressors. Meron ka ngang trabaho, wala ka namang support na nakukuha. So, just imagine this different stressor. Okay lang yan kung isa. What if they all come together? So, just imagine if you add all of them, the balancing act of the migrant women worker may be compromised. And this is where no, the mental health or the well-being of the migrant women worker will be put to the test. Next slide, please. So, according to Hans Selye, there are three stages if you are feeling stressed. So, tingnan nyo ang sarili nyo. Paano mo malalaman kung stress ka na? So, you just feel the strain, may trigger ka. Pero paano mo naramdaman ang stress? So, tatlo, sabi ni Selye, ang psychologist, sabi niya, there is what you call the alarm stage. There is the second is the resistance stage. And the third is the exhaustion stage, no? So, ang alarm stage, ito ang trigger. Okay? Ano ang trigger? May news kang narinig sa Pilipinas sa nangyayari sa mga anak mo. That is an alarm stage, no? Or dito man sa bansang pinagtatrabahuan mo, nagpapakita ng motibo yung arabo mong amo. That's an alarm stage, no? And then resistance stage. So next slide, please. So ano ang mangyari dito? What are the signs, no? Sa alarm stage, syempre kung nakikita mong may motibo na yung arabo mo, minsan it affects you physically. May mga signs yan. Okay? This is what you call, do I need to fight the stressor or do I need to run away from my stressor? So we call this the fight or flight stage, no? So it alarms you, tumutunog na siya. Kaya minsan katawan mo, no, bumibilis na yung paghinga mo lalo na kung nilalapitan ka ng arabo mo habang nagwawalis ka. Okay? So bumibilis ng timok ng puso mo, nanginginig ka na. So layasan ko na ba ito o hampasin ko na ba ito ng bote or ano? So minsan, no? So you have to think about that. So may alarm ka na. Okay, next slide, please. So this is now the resistance. What kind of strategy will I use if I want to manage this stressor? Okay, now if you can run away from the stressor, well and good. No, magtago ka sa kwarto, mag-lock ka, or tatawag ka sa Polo Owa Embassy para ma-alert sila, or you call your friend. Okay. Pero the danger is if you are exposed there regularly, no? Hindi nagle-let up yung trigger, no? So pati ikaw, na may mga effect na yan sa iyo kasi hindi ka pwede all the time to be nakakandado, no? What if gusto mo maglinis kasi hindi ka nakatapos ng trabaho mo because you were afraid, no? You are trying to protect yourself. What that will be taken against you. So, hindi ka na makatulog. Yun ang resistance, no? Kasi affected ka na. And then, malulungkot ka, magsisimula ng if you continue facing danger, then time will come. No? Katulad sa yung Pinay nga, no? Sa araw-araw na lang na binabantayan siya ng lalaking Arabo nang umalis yung asawa. So, that was the time when she was raped, no? So exhausted na siya, no? Kasi she was being threatened na isumbong siya, wala siyang passport, she couldn't leave the place, no? So double whammy, no? Pagod na siya, nagkasakit na siya, and then abuso pa siya. Okay, next slide please. So you don't have to wait for that third stage, no? Before that happens, no? You can already do something. Doon pa lang sa resistance, no? Protect yourself. Okay? Now, it might lead not only to tiredness for many, it might even lead to depression. It might even lead to the inability to cope and to some extreme ending their life, no? Hindi na sila makabawi, kaya nag-suicide na lang. Katulad sa isang Filipina sa Lebanon, hindi na siya makaalis doon sa sixth floor, lumundag siya in her attempt to escape the ammo. Lumundag niya yung six-story building at namatay siya. Okay, next slide please. So, what are the other signs of exhaustion? As I have said, okay, this will be the conditions that your well-being will be in jeopardy. Okay, next slide please. Now, what are the things that you need also to be at the lookout, no, that will lead you to experience general anxiety, no, sa work? So we call this gas, no? So hindi ito gas na you cannot see that we cook. So this is the equivalent of the stage of Hans Selye. So other elements that can lead you or push you to the extreme will be relationship breakdowns. So minsan kaya mo ang mga difficult work in the destination country, but when the family is already put on the spot, no, when you hear news that will break your heart, so it will not just break you emotionally, it will also break you physically. Okay, or you lose your job. Imagine there are six mouths to feed in the Philippines, and if you lose your job, no, you cannot still pay your debt, no, and you had no work. So even if you have work, if you cannot leave also the destination country because of the pandemic, so you had nothing to send because many remittance centers are not also open and working. So then you will have your medical problem. Ito ang sabi ng kaibigan kong doktor. Nasabi niya, mga nanay, dala-dala nila anak sa labas. Hindi lang naisip na pag ang anak na nila magkasakit, hindi nila mabisitahan pag COVID na ito. Hindi mo ito mahawakan. Remember, iba ang sakit ng COVID. Huh? You cannot even come near your loved one, nor even converse with your loved one. No, my tita, the sister of my father, and my cousin died of COVID. And my other cousin was just looking from afar. She couldn't even touch her mom because of COVID. So that aggravates the feeling of separation. No? Just because kasing anak ko na buriyong na, so ilabas, hindi na na-realize na once the kid also gets sick, then they cannot even take good care of them in this time of the pandemic. And then that not only that you cannot take care of them, what will you pay for the hospitalization? No? I have a friend who died in the hospital in this pandemic, and he paid 1.3 million just for 6 days. Eh, kung wala kang trabaho. So, mabuti na lang kung may trabaho ka. But you see, imagine that can eat your resources. No? Imagine instead of giving the money for the family, you will be giving that to the hospital for the loved relative who is sick. Next slide, please. So, what are the 7 things that you can do at this time of the pandemic, whether you are in the destination country or here in the Philippines? So I am suggesting 7, and I think this will be deepened more by Dr. Paz, my colleague. No? So One, if you feel that you are anxious. Okay, so we are in the alarm stage. Okay, wala pa yung resistance. And you know that you are already feeling, you know, the impact of stress. You can sit in one corner. We call this the diaphragmatic breathing. No? When we breathe, usually it is our chest that moves up and down. When you do the diaphragm breathing, it is the tummy that goes up and down. So that means to say it's a deep breathing that will calm you down. So hawakan mo yung dibdib mo at ang tiyan, tingnan mo ang kaibahan. No? So huminga ka, ano ba ang tumataas baba? Is it your chest or is it your tummy? Okay, so when you feel stress, you can do this exercise, count 1 to 10. Repeat it several times until you calm down. No? So when you are at rest and you feel anxious at night before you sleep, do this exercise. This will bring back, no, your breathing, and this will lower down your anxiety. Pangalawa na technique or strategy is what we call the progressive muscle relaxation. So halimbawa, stress ka ngayon. So you just hold your two hands. You squeeze you close your fingers to a fist, and then you throw it up, no? And say, ha, you open it. You make a sound, release the tension out there in the air. That can also relieve your anxiety. Or if you feel the stress or the tension in your shoulders, you pull it up, no? You squeeze it and then you release it, pull it down suddenly. No? So muscle relaxation can bring back the normal flow of oxygen in your brain, and that can also bring you to a calm state of mind. No? So you can practice this. So be aware of that part of your body and then tense it, and then release the tension in that part of the body until you feel relaxed. Another one, strategy is the guided imagery. No? So sa gabi, pag hindi ka makatulog, no? So just imagine that you are in Boracay, kung nakapunta ka na, or in a place that you really want to go that gives you relaxation. Or you can imagine your family that you are enjoying together. So that is what you will be putting yourself while relaxing and fighting the anxiety that you're experiencing at the moment. Okay? So until you calm down. Okay? Or you can play a music together with your guided imagery. Okay? And then another one will be explained by Doc Paz. Or the other one is physical activity. Yung exercise sabi natin, no? May bago ngayon na skipping rope, no? You don't even have to jump. Okay? They call this the rope flow. No, may hawak ka lang na rope, hindi ka lumulundag, pero you simulate the movement of the rope as if you are jumping. And that is a form of exercise that can already relieve you from your anxiety or stress. No? You can Google the rope flow. Okay? So you don't have to go outside of the house of your employer if they don't allow you. No? So even in your room, you can do the rope flow. No? It is a form of exercise as if you are doing the same rope exercise outside, no? Of the home. And the other one is definitely, if you want to reduce the triggers of your stress, then avoid, limit, or see to it that you always have somebody with you so that the person that you want to avoid cannot do any harm to you. So think of how to avoid the triggers so you don't have to expose yourself to the triggers. So remember, if the fly will always come near the fire, time will come that the fly will burn. So if you want to be safe, don't play with fire. In other words, avoid, distance yourself from the triggers that cause you the stress so that you will not be put at risk. Next slide, please. So self-care doesn't mean me first. It means me too. Remember, my dear migrant women workers, you are not just doing this for your family. We know that many of our migrant women workers are guilty to think na to think of themselves. They didn't realize that they are part of the well-being. They are not just thinking of the well-being of the family, but they are also had to include their well-being. Sila actually yung balon ng kagalingan. If they want to sustain, no? Dala-dala mo yung kahusayan. Dala-dala mo yung kagalingan, hindi ka kailan magkasakit. Because mental health is not absence of sakit, no? Of illness, but it is a state of well-being. And if you are being well, you will always be mentally healthy, and you can always be ready to face opportunities that will lead you to success. Next slide, please. And therefore, what are the four C's that I am recommending sa paghahanda sa iyong paglalakbay? No? So our stakeholders can also add these when they brief or orient their migrant workers, okay, in their journey or pagpakisapalaran sa ibang bansa. The first is never, the first C, continuous care of self. It doesn't mean that just because you left the home country, you forget about self. Remember, you cannot give what you do not have. Ang balon ng kagalingan ay dala mo. It's within you. So continuously take good care of yourself. You are a part of your success. Okay? It is just like, anhin mo ang golden egg. Kung namatay ang goose that lays the golden egg, ikaw yun ang goose. Okay? So, huwag papadala ka ng golden egg. Pero kung wala ka naman, wala silbi. Pangalawa, connecting with loved ones. Okay? Before you leave the country, see to it that you have your cell phone. See to it that you have their numbers. See to it that you have the number of your close friend. See to it that you have the number of your agency. See to it that you have the number of the community where you will be working. See to it that you have the number of the Philippine labor office in the country of destination. So kahit, and see to it that you also have the copy of your contract. I-screenshot mo. Kasi if they get your contract paper, you still have something to check yourself kung tama ba ang binibigay sa iyo o hindi. So ito ang pangatlong C, no? Collaborate with the Filipino community in the country of destination. Huwag kaligtaan. Huwag mag-isa. Don't isolate yourself. This is very critical. You are not alone. No? At pang-apat, cooperate with our government agencies. I know that our government agencies in destination countries are always taking the initiative to reach out to our migrant workers. Okay, so get in touch with them. Okay, they have programs for you. And so we hope that you have also their numbers. You know whom to contact. And you know that they are there for you. That's the reason why we have the office in the destination country. So again, remember the four C's. If you want to be successful, if you want to be prepared in your journey, no, don't take for granted these forces. Next slide, please. And with this, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jack, for that very extensive presentation. So now, yes, kung may questions po, pwedeng later during the open forum. Let's have Dr. Paz first for her presentation of Mindfulness 101. Dr. Paz, please.
Thank you. Thank you for that, no? Again, sinabi nga ni Doc Jack kanina, no, that self-care is also very important, right? And if we want to look into self-care, no, as something to care for our well-being, it is very important that we practice mindfulness. Can you see the slide?
Yes.
Can you see the slide? And am I good in terms of
Yes po, ma'am.
Okay, so thank you. Thank you again. Thank you again, Ms. Mel. Thank you again, Dr. What do you call this? Doc Jerry, and of course, the group of Dawn for the invite. And we will now look into the practical aspects, no, of mindfulness 101 that has been mentioned, no, as an intervention for stress. Okay, so I will give you the simple things that you can do in a daily basis, and yung sinabi rin ni Doc Jerry kanina on exercise and all, we can all incorporate, no, mindfulness in the tips that was given. So I move on now. So when we talk about mindfulness 101 and this portion of the talk, we will be looking into understanding the science of mindfulness. This has been studied and it was proven that it helps people, no, alleviate the stress. And again, very important when we look into our mental health, because definitely because of this time of pandemic, our mental health, no, has really gone up. And this is global in nature in terms of problems in corporate world for our OFWs, no, also in our family. Mental health is a big thing to consider nowadays. And of course, what is important is we learn some mindfulness techniques. So this is not only the lecture, but we have to practice it, no? Know about it so that we can start applying it maybe tonight and later on, no? Make it part of our daily practice in life. Put mindfulness in, okay? So it was mentioned by Sir Jay, again, the connection between stress and mindfulness. And when you look into that, na mentioned kanina, that stress triggers our brain threat system, no? Yung brain natin sinasabi, there's danger there, no? And when we acknowledge that there's danger, yung brain natin, no, releases a hormone, the stress hormone, which we call the cortisol, that activates our sympathetic nervous system. Kaya nga we have the either we fight or we run away, no? Because we want to get out of danger. But can you imagine, no? Kung everyday man lang sa atin, we're always stressed out. We're always, tatakbo ba ako? Ulala ba? Can you imagine everyday being in that? Ay nako, I tell you, maybe blood pressure will be high, cholesterol levels natin high, kasi parang everyday we're always stressed out if we're always in the sympathetic mode ng nervous system. Kaya sometimes we have to go parasympathetic. Kung maalala pa ninyo yung biology ninyo, yung science, para sympathetic nervous system, so that we're also in the relaxed mode. That should always be a balance. Okay? So as we move on, no, as I mentioned, ang dami ng studies, research, huh, that the practice of mindfulness is an effective stress management tool. Nakita kanina, minention ni Sir Jay, all these different types of stress. And as psychologists, as counselors, we want to work on the stress doon pa sa alarm stage, no? So that hindi na lalala, alarm stage, we already start to practice mindfulness. So with regular mindfulness practice, we become more mentally strong. And that's very important for well-being, no? Mentally strong because whatever we think about affects our actions, no? So it's good that we think about what are the effective strategies so that it will also, we are also make sure that our behavior, no, is not that of impulse, but that of a planned decision. So we will become less reactive. We are more stress resilient. We will be able to handle the challenges of life that we have experienced. Ang daming sinabi kanina, no, talagang grabbing experience of some of our women migrant workers, no? But these challenges, we might be able to again accept them, no, with calm, with clearer perspective, and also with clarity. So when we look at this, no, all of us, we are all capable of practicing mindfulness. We have that in us already. Yun nga lang, siguro nakalimutan na natin kasi ang daming ginagawa sa buhay. Parang na-guilty pa tayo that we are calm, nagigilty tayo pag nagre-relax tayo because we think there's so much to do, no? But mindfulness is the basic human ability to be fully present, to be in the now, no? Aware of where we are, okay? And what we're doing, and not overly reactive or overwhelmed by what's going on around us. So kung nanenerbius na lahat, natatakot ka na, you will be overwhelmed. And the more that you will not be able to think well. No, that's why, that's where mindfulness come in. Diba ang ganda ng picture na yan? Parang time stands still, no? And that woman is just there, no? Maybe feeling the air, looking at the flowers, just staying still. I'm sure karamihan sa atin parang, naku, waste of time yan, no? But if you look at it, it's not a waste of time because it's telling your body, your mind, hold muna, relax muna, kasi stressed ka. So we will look further and check further on mindfulness. So it's simply, no? A way, no? Of trying to live in the present moment. Kasi kung minsan sabi, naku, parang napakahirap yung mindfulness na yan. Kailangan mag-meditate, kailangan may time ka, kailangan may training ka. No, you don't need all those things, no? Little, what do you call this, practice in mindfulness, incorporating it, and you find your own, what do you call this, your own technique later on, will go a long, long way, no? In your practice of mindfulness. So you see, it's finding a way to be in the present a moment. And being in that present moment, when we look into it, no, there is no judgment, no? We don't overthink kasi karamihan nag-overthink tayo. So nagwo-worry na tuloy tayo, hindi pa nangyayari, iniisip na natin, no? And that can distract us, that can cause stress. So let's find some ways that we could be mindful. So again, some techniques here will work for some, others may not. So you find out what will work for you. Ano yung bagay sa inyo? Kasi iba-iba tayo ng personality, iba-iba tayo ng environment, iba-iba yung level ng well-being natin, no? So I will give you a lot of maybe some techniques here, no? Some things that you can do and you can experiment and try what will best work for you. Okay? So one thing that you can be mindful of that could practice mindfulness is making a gratitude journal. Okay, writing down things that you are thankful for. Very important that you see the good even when things go wrong. Kung baga sa baso with water, you don't see it as half empty, but you see it as half full. Okay, so either a gratitude journal, either a notebook, either or maybe may coupon band kayo sa tabi ng kama ninyo pag matutulog kayo, you can write down, what is the thing that I should be thankful about for the day? What is something good that happened to me today that I am thankful for? Kasi sometimes we forget, no? Because we're all focused on the negative, we're all focused on ang hirap ng buhay, nalilimutan natin yung mga maliliit na bagay that made us laugh, that made us happy during the day, and we should remember that. Because when we start looking into what we should be thankful about, no, we realize that every day may positibo, no? Every day there was something good that happened. Kaya lang siguro mas madami nung negative na kalimutan na natin, no? This little glimpse of light that we might see, no? And when we do this, when we practice this, no, our brain will learn to accept, no, that there are really also some good things in life, and maybe the glass is not half empty but half full. So again, it's a way of training your brain, so you can look into this, no? And why are we talking about a gratitude journal? Because again, science would show, studies would show that if you're a thankful person, you're grateful, it affects also the health of your heart, cardiovascular and immune functioning, okay? You are less likely to be sick, no? If you have that, if you're able to be grateful, no, of the things that you see. Also, gratitude is the strength that is linked to satisfaction and happiness. The more grateful you are, the more content you are with life because you're grateful, no? The more you will have positive emotions because you're contented, okay? And also, even if there are bad things about your work, you get to enjoy your work, no? Because you are grateful that kahit papano, may trabaho ka. Kung wala ka man trabaho ngayon, kahit papano, there's something that you're doing, you're here with your family, no? Kahit papano, you have also surpassed, no? COVID, and maybe all these things that you can find out, no? That you should be thankful about, no? And maybe, what do we do also every day? We walk going to the market, sa Talipapa. We walk at home. We walk around the village, no? But we walk, no? So maybe even while we're walking, no? We're already trying to walk mindfully. You see, so like I said, it's not something that you have to, dapat may schedule ako pag maging mindful ako, no? You can even do this while you're walking. So what do you do when you walk? No, you try to focus on one thing. Maybe you focus on how you're walking, the steps you're taking. Maybe you're focusing on the air that you feel while you're walking. Maybe you're focusing on the people that you're meeting. Kasi ang hirap, usually when we walk, we look at so many things, so we get distracted. Nagmamadali na tayo and everything because parang ang dami-dami natin iniisip. But when we're walking, we try to be to do mindful walking, no? So if your mind wanders, iba na naman ang nakita, distract ka, go it back again, no? I'm walking and I'm also being mindful of how I'm breathing. I'm walking and I'm being mindful about the sounds that I hear, okay? What could happen here? You may feel more at peace with less mind rumination. Because if you're focused on how you're walking, maybe iniisip din yung utang, problema dyan, nawawala kahit papano because you're focused on the steps that you're taking. Okay? So even when you're eating, no? So even when you're eating, you appreciate, no? So that madistract lang kayo sa problema, you appreciate the smell perhaps of the coffee that you're drinking and then mag-relax kayo, smell the coffee, no? Maybe the taste of the coffee. Ah, matamis ito ngayon. Ah, maalat. All of those things. So when you're focused on that, medyo nawawala yung mga constraints ninyo, but you are at that present moment. And that's also very important that you train your brain to be distracted because this will also give you strengths later on, no, to be able to think better. So when this happens, both your mind and body will feel better. And it will also reduce your stress, no? You know, some people, they don't eat mindfully, kaya nag-gain na sila ng weight. Kasi dapat magmadali na akong kumain kasi late na. Kain ng kain, nakalimutan, ang dami na palang nasubong rice or something, they gain weight, no? Or others, they forget to eat because they're so distracted. But if you're mindful about what you put in your tummy, in your mouth and all, then you are able to decide, oh, tama na kasi full na ako eh. Feeling ko full na ako. Sometimes kasi we eat mindlessly, di ba? So we don't also savor, no, the flavor and we are not even aware kung busog na tayo o gutom pa. Okay? Yung sinabi nga rin kanina, that part of releasing our stress is doing exercise. And when you exercise, you can also be doing it mindfully. Okay? Concentrating as you do your exercise. So when you look at it, that's not a waste of time. It's not a waste of time if you're mindful about all the things that you do. Okay? So when you're walking out, getting exercise, you have your exercise there, you're thinking about good thoughts. You train your mind. Hindi yung nag-exercise ka, pero galit na galit kayo, etc. No? So that's again very stressful. No? So maybe when you're angry while you're exercising, no, you think about that anger. That's being mindful. I'm angry right now. I'm mad right now. Kaya mabilis yung pagtakbo ninyo, mabilis yung boxing exercises ninyo, but you're mindful about it. That's the present moment so that again, you're in touch with your emotions. No? It's not something that you're also trying to run away from. Now, because others say, so that you will be distracted, run away from it, exercise ka, you will forget. It can also be that when you exercise and you're mindful about it, you're thinking also, no, about what could be, no, these negative events, no, the negative emotions, you're mindful of it, but again, you're not judging. You're not judging saying na mali ito, dapat hindi ako galit, etc. But just feel it and accept, I'm mindful now, I'm angry. Okay, so I'm thinking about it, But later on, I will not show that I'm angry, but I admit that I'm angry right now. Because sometimes we get stressed out when we always deny, no, what is happening inside our mind. So your stress level is immediately better when you exercise. So these are some form of mindful activities as well. Okay, so if you look at it, ang dami palang magawa ng mindfulness, and it can be incorporated in so many activities, no? Yoga is more relaxing. If you are more of the person na hindi talagang physical, no, but you want to take things slowly, then either yoga or even tai chi, di ba? Kaya dito yung sinasabi nga kanina ni Sergio, yung progressive relaxation, di ba? When you do yoga at all, progressive yung pag-relax ng katawan mo. So that the more flexible you may become. So you learn to relax and focus on something other than the worries in your mind. What are you focusing here? Your balance, your position, di ba? The movements, okay? So you forget negative things for a moment, no? Because you're focused on doing yoga, no? Or maybe tai chi. We're focused on the movements, no? At the present moment, okay? So as we move on, meditate, no? So again, meditation has been, maybe sinasabi yan, you only do it when you're Buddhist, when you're a Buddhist, when you're this. But you know, in all religions, everybody meditates. We just call it in different names. Maybe for us Christians, prayer is a form of meditation. Diba? For Buddhists, it's part of their life. They meditate, they think. That's why you see, no? They're very relaxed, no? Hindi sila hyper palagi. Maybe because they started their day with meditation. So today, I will be this person. Today, I will be grateful. So na-prep na sila, no? Na-prep na sila that relax na ako because I know that I will be facing stress later on. Others, they call this also mga stress-free Mondays. So Mondays, they start already to do meditation, to de-stress themselves so that they will be ready for the stresses for the week. Okay? And when you meditate, pwede rin meron kayong guided imagery. Ni? Kung hindi man kayo nakapunta sa Boracay, you can have a picture by your wall. No? That is very relaxing and you can just stare at it, get lost in that image. And that's also where you see, no, the power of our mind to create nice visions for us to be relaxed, nice visuals. So we can also control that. So if we always have violent visual, let's change it to something that would calm us down. And that is what we can do because we have this control. No? So when you do this, you have taught your mind to escape rumination when needed. Lalo na na overthinking na naman kayo, na-stress na naman kayo. So parang take a pause and say, okay, go back muna ako sa akin vacation place, no? Go back muna ako sa magandang place. Maybe a blank wall somewhere, no? In your room, in the house, no? That you could just stare on and you could call it, this is my, ano to, this is my relaxed corner, okay? So we can come up with some strategies, no? That we may have. It may not cost much. It could even be free, no? We just have to strategize and see what can work, no? If it was mentioned a while ago, the breathing exercise, there are a lot of different techniques to breathing, no? Yung sinasabi nga lang, wag lang tayong mag-breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. It's also very stressful. So there should be a way to breathe that would also help us. Maybe we could try this, no? Here the one counting to four. So maybe we can put one hand on our chest, no? The other one on our belly. Okay. Maybe you can follow me. Let's inhale for a count of four, then exhale for a count of four. Okay. So inhale. One, two, three, four. Exhale. One, two, three, four. Repeat. Inhale. One, two, three, four. Exhale. One, two, three, four. So maybe you can do this 10 times, 5 times, 8 times, no? What would be best for you? Yung importante lang dyan, the counting, no? And you're mindful of your breathing, no? Okay, and you can repeat this. I don't know if it worked for you as we did it, even for like 2 times or 3 times lang. Kung may effect na yan sa'yo, you can share this later, no? But these are things also that you can do, no? When we talk about belly breathing. Again, science would show that there's the connection between this kind of breathing with oxygen that we breathe in and breathe out that connects also to the brain to make us in a relaxed mode. Okay, so there's also that connection. And maybe just to repeat some of the things that has been said, no? It was mentioned, but anyway, you will have also copies of the slide. So yeah, any corner in your room, no? It doesn't have to be like parang you have to go to some place, spend for it or what, but maybe in one corner in the garden, outside, take a seat. You can be in your ano to, barangay park, di ba? Find a place to sit that feels calm and quiet to you. You also can have a time limit. Maybe 5 minutes will do, 10 minutes will do. You see, it's very short, but it could help you for the rest of the day if you were able to prep yourself well and if you were able to give yourself some time to relax. So very important also that you notice your body, no? You can notice how comfortable are you, relaxed na ba kayo, what is bugging you, no? So that's also very important, no? Then try to feel your breathing. No? How are you breathing? Are you in a relaxed state? Nagmamadali pa kayo? Okay, so that's very important. Then you start already doing your belly breathing if you would want to. Then if later on, going back again sa problema ninyo, nako, magbabayad pa ako ng kuryente, magbabayad pa ako na, go back again. I'm relaxing right now. This is my time to relax. This is my time to self-care. Okay, so train your mind to go back to that. Okay, and at the same time, no, if it doesn't work for you yet, no, because it's not only like tapos na to, itry na ninyo, okay na yan, you'll have to practice it. It will not be instant. So when this happens, you be kind again to yourself, to your wandering mind. Don't judge yourself. Hindi naman nag-work sa akin, siguro because I'm just so stressed out. Just take time to practice it again. When it wanders, then go back again, no? So again, when meron din sa YouTube, all of those things that you can download and try, it doesn't have to be 5 minutes kaagad. You can start with 3 minutes and later on, as you get the hang of it, it could go to 8 minutes, 10 minutes, etc. No? You know, one thing that I could also be thankful about, grateful about, it's only really now that I'm appreciating mindfulness. No, I've heard about it, done that, but it's only really now that I'm really appreciating it. Because it was also very hard for me to just think of nothing. Kasi parang, when you think of nothing, parang wala kang gagawin. But you know, it's so important when you just empty your mind and just be someplace and just let things flow, no? And after that, you would be very relaxed. And now it's part, no, of my daily routine, no? I have mindfulness in the morning. I do that. And also before I sleep, no? I empty my mind, okay? Or you can also practice this. O mag-practice tayo ngayon, di ba? In your own way, no? You try to acknowledge 5 things that you can see around you. So maybe habang nakaupo kayo ngayon, ano nakikita ninyo? Cabinet, siguro, may tasa dyan, andyan yung aso, o andyan yung pintuan, andyan yung nanay ko. So that's also being mindful, no? Because na-distract kayo, what are the 5 things around me, no? And then you can look into what are the 4 things that I can touch. So mahawakan ko ang akin cellphone, mahawakan ko ang akin tasa, mahawakan ko yung akin ballpen, mahawakan ko ang akin notebook, okay? So maybe you can then you also practice, no? Be mindful about what you hear, no? So these are practices that you can do. What is it that I can hear? O yung tunog ng electric fan, yung maingay na aso sa labas, no? Yung anak ko nakikipag-away, something like that. But at least you're acknowledging it. You're mindful of that. Then you can also do, what are the 2 things that I can smell, no? So maybe, ay nako, may nagluluto sa labas, nagba-barbecue, ay nako, yung kape na amoy ko. And maybe one thing that you can taste, no? From where you are. So again, this helps in distracting you. This helps in practicing mindfulness around you, no? To make you more sensitive to what is going on around. No? Nagkauso din, even during the pre-pandemic, nagkauso din yung adult coloring book, no? So try to check into it. Kung hindi adult coloring book ng mga anak ninyo, or if not, you can always download, no? You can always download some prints for you to color, no? And they found out that this is also anti-stress, a stress reliever. I have one and I tried doing it, no? But when I was doing it, sabi ko, nako, mas lalo akong nai-stress. Kasi iniisip ko pa kung anong sunod na kulay na gagamitin ko kasi nagamit ko na yan. So, iisip na naman ako anong kulay. Sabi ko, bakit sinasabing anti-stress ito? Nai-stress ako sa kapakulay, no? And then I just let it happen. I won't think about what kung ano ng next kulay na gagamitin ko. Basta mag-color lang ako. Diba? So, no, and when I did that, flow, no? There was flow. I was relaxed. I just didn't think about what would be the next one. Ano na lang kukunin ko, i-color ko. Then, after that, ang ganda naman pala yung na-color ko, di ba? Without really like thinking about what the next color will be, no? And you know, I tell you, when pandemic started, yung sinabi na sa amin, wala ng klase, lockdown na, etc. Yun in my mindset, sabi ko, nako, talaga na palang nangyari ito. Because we were still in the stage of denial, di ba? Na parang, ay, hindi sa China lang yan, hindi tayo maano yan, di ba? So during that time na talagang, it's really here na, my personality kasi is, I take a pause muna. Iba-iba tayo ng personality. So I just stopped everything. I went and got my ano ba to? Painting by numbers that I didn't have time to do before. Hinalungkat ko. So for that 1 week, wala akong ginawa but to what do you call this color to paint. That's why I had this, no? So that when I finished it, then I said, "Okay, I'm ready na. Accept ko na may pandemic." Accept ko na yung mga ibang changes na mangyayari. Because for me, I had to find my inner strength first to be able to face the changes that may happen. So that made me stronger in terms of my mental health and accepting na talaga palang may pandemic na. Diba? Kasi it will not be immediate, no? Kanya-kanyang personality ito, diba? My husband naman nung pandemic na, ano na yan? Plano na ng plano. Ano nang gagawin? That was how he dealt with his stress. So I'm not saying that mindfulness is just the way, being relaxed is not the way. But for some people, they have to move, no? And they're mindful about their movements and it works for them. Okay, so there are other ways and we just have to discover what will work for us in terms of using mindfulness as a way to relieve our stress. Others, it's really through the prayer. And maybe we should consider this because again, the Philippines is a largely Catholic country and a lot really, no? And maybe you're already doing this, just staring at Mama Mary, staring at baby Jesus, Santo Niño, staring at a picture, no? And just being there with the Lord, no? Not asking for anything, just being there, and you know that helps people, no? That helps people become strong, and this is also a kind of mindfulness, no? They just didn't put this also in all of those things because now we're sensitive about religion and all, but this is also a form of mindfulness, no? Taken from people with different religions. So we've been practicing this a long, long time ago. Kung Buddhism nga, they have their own form of mindfulness, iba meditation. Maybe for us, our meditations are a form of prayer, no? Just being silent inside the church. So that could be one form, no? What is free? Nature is free, no? So take a picture, go out in the park, go out in the garden, it's free. Wherever you are, just stare, no? At the flowers, look at the colors. Iba-ibang makita natin. Maybe others who are looking at the photo now will look at ang pink na mga flowers. Others might say, may mga nag-bloom pa. Diba? That's focusing yourself. Or here, Others might look at the plants. Others might see, it's morning, so the sun is about to shine. Iinit na yan mamaya, but you are just there in the present moment and you're just staring at the picture at this time. And these are also things that could relax you. Okay? Because we should remember, no, that what we think we are, no, focuses, no, what we think we are, our thoughts, our beliefs, our feelings, no, affect the behavior that we do. Okay? And if our thoughts are negative and if we believe that wala nang mangyayari, then we get anxious and our behavior will always be negative na, no? Or maybe something that has to do with wala na talaga, no hope anymore, give up na ako, no? And we should not let ourselves go to that. So, umpisa pa lang sa alarm stage, no? We are already cognizant, no? Iniisip na natin ito upang hindi na lalala, no? Kaya nga ito yung well-being na sinasabi eh. We have to catch it while it's there and be aware of it because it might be too late kung hintayin pa natin yung exhaustion stage na sinasabi, no? So sabi nga ni Buddha, Buddhism, our life is shaped by our mind for we become what we think. Okay? So important, no, if we want to look into the future, self-care. We have to take care of the future best by taking care of the present now. So ano pang future ang maiisip natin if ngayon pa lang give up na tayo, if ngayon pa lang takot na tayo? Because definitely things will change again, no? Pag wala na itong pandemic, but there will be a different way of doing things, no? It cannot go back to how it was before. So we already have to know how to handle, no, our mental health, well-being, so that when change would happen again, kaya na natin. And we just have to practice this in our daily life. So thank you. And maybe you can check some resources here. So thank you for your attention. Ma'am, we're good?
I'll stop. Yeah. Thank you very much, Dr. Paz. For that very practical and very interesting presentation. So I'm sure there'll be many questions for Dr. J and Dr. Paz. But before that, we would like to have a group cloud chat. Can we all please open our videos before tayo magtanong, no? Yeah. Okay, let's all open our videos so we can have a group cloud chat. Jude, can you please open your video? Hello, everyone.
Thank Hi, you everyone.
Si Miss Maribik. Miss Maribik, please open your video. Okay, Joy, please. Si Ma'am Oi. Ma'am Oi. Ma'am Oi.
Baka nagma-mindfulness exercise.
Smile! Isa pa po. One, two, three. Thank you, everyone.
Sige po. So now, thank you very much. Let's now go to the open forum, and Lance Velasco will be our facilitator for the open forum. Lance is with Dawn and the Philippine Migrants Rights Watch. So Lance, please.
Hello po. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for the discussions on mindfulness. I think everyone is very stressed during the pandemic, and I hope you have to know that we have to have time for ourselves And before we start with our open forum, I would like to acknowledge some of our participants who have been part of our of today's webinar. So I would like to acknowledge the presence of our representatives from Polo and OWA, particularly from Singapore and the UK. I'm very happy mga taga UK kahit very early doon attend po sa ating webinar today. Then you also have some representatives from DSWD and MDSW, the Social Welfare Department of Manila, is also part of their webinar. Then you also have a representative from Cyprus, the Filipino Community of Cyprus. So thank you very much for joining us as well. Then we also have partners from our civil society, from our NGOs, CSOs. We have CAMPI, we have CMA and SMC. So Ms. Cecil is there also, thank you. And we also have our volunteers from Australia. So we have Ms. Jude and Ms. Janelle with us. Thank you for joining us for this webinar. So as we're going to start our open forum, I would like to request everyone to just, if you have any questions, just feel free to raise your hands. Or if you have a question, just feel free to leave a comment on our chat box. So the floor is open for everyone now. So any questions? The floor is open to everyone. Just feel free to raise your hands. So I have to look at the slide. So let me see first one. There's one comment here from Ma'am Oi. I'll just check it out. So ang comment po niya is that, let me see. The biggest stressors these days is the financial stress. So bills to pay, which is experienced by everyone. So thank you for this. So she gave a comment for Doc Jen, Doc Pass, for doing doable stress management techniques. The pandemic will be long term, so we really need to relax and adjust the situation. So which is true. Very, and I think one problem with the pandemic is that it's providing stress at a different level. It's not only a particular aspect, but it's combined. Everything is financial, physical, emotional. So the question is, because we have to deal with several aspects of distress, type of, what do we first address out of all these aspects? Do we first address the emotional aspect, or do we, kasi yun yun eh, everyone is stressed, there's so much in on their plate, what do we do? What do we address first? Any of the two resource person may answer this one.
Doc Paz?
Yeah, okay, then maybe we'll look into it. So no, you know, it's very important, no, that the emotional aspect is very important. Sometimes we forget about this, no? And we say, no, 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 bury it first because there are practical things to do. Okay, if it's okay with you that postpone muna because I have priorities, mm-hmm. fine. But how long will that postponement be? Because it catches back later on. Okay, so it could be that maybe I have priorities, so I cannot cry now. I have to work on this. Okay, work on this. If it's okay, then go back and cry. Okay, because it will take its toll later on. So we don't forget about emotions and say that it's nothing, but I have to be practical, but acknowledge it, because emotions, they're neutral. They're not right or wrong. It's what we do that makes it right or wrong. That's why meron yung management of stress, management of our emotions, but we really have to acknowledge that this is how we feel. Okay, so maybe that's my take on that, Lance, and maybe Doc J can add to that.
Just to add to what Doc Pa said, for me, what is important is to work on the body and the mind. No? These two are always together. What the mind feels, the body feels as well. What the body feels, the mind gets affected as well. In other words, it's the total person that you have to focus on. Okay. So it's the self-care. You cannot just simply say right now, well, I just have to focus on this. But remember, when we act as a person. We don't act separately in different dimensions. So But definitely, if what is affecting you the most at the moment is more on the emotional, then perhaps you give it a little bit of time. But remember, you always have to go back and bring the body as well, because these two will always be working together. And you cannot simply make use of one at the expense of the other. So when you focus, it's always looking at the total person. Okay, that's why self-care is not simply one aspect. No? Kasi pag yan ang mangyari, we might have the tendency of dichotomizing the individual migrant worker and simply say, ah, this is the priority. Always, what is the context of this particular dimension in the totality of my person? So at the end of the day, you are the one, the person who is affected. Okay? You cannot just simply say, oh, it is just my body who is affected. Kasi pag napukpok mo yung daliri mo, it's not just the daliri who says, aray. It's the whole person who says, aray. Ouch. So, ikaw yung ang kabuuhan. Kaya, you cannot give what you do not have. We want to help others, but we always have to start with ourselves first. So, yun lang ang pinakip. Kaya ang mindfulness ni Doc Paz is a mindfulness of the total being, not a mindfulness of one aspect of the person. Kaya ang well-being is the total wellness of the person, not what. Kaya ang balon ng kagalingan, ng kahusayan, ng tao, ay buo yan. No? Yung pagkatao ng migrant worker.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. And maybe I just also want to emphasize, that's why even in your group now, you saw the need to put in psychosocial, psychosocial aspect of mental health, because you saw that it was not enough, no? That there should still be something that could be added there. Okay. And that's really the psychosocial aspect.
Yes. Thank you very much. Some of our participants are just providing their comments. So one is from Ms. Carmelita Morante. So we need coordinated response to migrant workers' concerns, because hopping from one place to another adds layer of stress to the situation. Is this the stress to the one who's providing the care or the migrant worker? It can be both ways then. It's stressful for us. Yeah. So to that, because there's a stress hopping from one place to another. At the same time, yung receiving care, because minsan hindi sila makakuha ng necessary services, that's also part of building stress for them. Lalo na yung, I remember there's this case na to go lang to the polo or to the diplomatic post, it takes them hours to go there. So, tapos pagdating naman doon, wala naman. Pero yung mga ganong situation. So, both sides have their own particular stress. So, mahirap din. It's really difficult to help each other if everyone is stressed out. So, this is very important that we try to find ways to have a time out, try to unwind or look some, to reflect on what's going on. Yes. And then the next comment ay yung from Cyprus, okay, Ms. Armelita Sunga. So she has no more question. She is citing an example that she's practicing part of it, and I learned more today. She's using the 100 beads prayer of the rosary. So thank you very much for organizing the webinar. So which is good. So there are ways of really distressing. So being in faith, practicing your faith is also one good way of helping out, reaching out to the Lord, and that is also one good way of helping reflect and trying to distress. See, Ms. Fe, yes, you raise your hand. Can you, yes.
Okay.
Feel free to answer, yes.
Okay. No, I'm asking questions.
Oh, sige lang.
Kasi kahapon, 2 days kami nag-conduct ng parang focus group discussion on mental health para sa mga OFWs. First day namin, we have 58 OFWs. Yung iba na sa Saudi, nag-join sa ganito. And then, the second day is we have 20 participants coming in. Napakaganda nung binigay ni Dr. Paz at saka ni Dr. Jerry. kasi nakita ko doon yun. Ang lumalabas kasi na stressor nila, well, tama-tama sinabi ni doktor, yung tungkol sa kanilang amo, yung kanilang family din, ay stressor din pala yan. Ano? So, tapos yung sitwasyon, tama rin ang binanggit niya na pera, isa, number one yan. And the family, isipin mo, kala ko naman ang family hindi stressor. Stressor din pala siya because of pera siguro, kaperahan. Yun ang nakita namin. And then the second day ko, parang ang daming gustong book, ano tawag dito? Doon sa 78 na yun, mayroong mga 10 na OFW ang gustong magpakamatay. Doon, nagulat kami. So, ha, bakit? Kasi stress na stress daw. Kasi yung 10 na inabutan ng ano, ng pandemic sa kanilang mga trabaho sa abroad. Tapos wala silang magawa dahil hindi naman sila napapasweldohan. Ganun ang klase. So, nagugustuhan ko yung sinabi mo, Ma'am Dr. Rapaz, kasi dapat pala yung mga OFW, bibigyan natin ng ganyang mga pag-aaral. Ano ba yung pwedeng para marilive na yung stress nila sa buhay, di ba? Ngayon ko nga lang nalaman na family stressor din, ano? Merong mga time na naglaslas daw ng sa kamay, merong iba gusto talaga magbitin kasi hindi makauwi, yung mga ganung klase. So, ang mga request ko sana is maganda sana meron tayong ganito na pero ang OFW bibigyan natin ng mga katulad ng ginawa ni Ma'am Pascal, mindfulness 101 something, di ba? Para ba ma-relieve mga stress eh mag-exercise ka pala. Doon ko nakita na pwede pala yung mag-iisip ka lang ng mga something about your five ano senses, di ba? Yung mga ganun. Hindi alam yan ng OFW. So napakaganda nitong timing na ko Ma'am ano Carmelita. Kailangan natin ito sa ating mga OFWs. And then, tapos alam niyo po ba talaga umiiyak po sa inyo talaga nang nagsasalita? Stressor ang family. Sisipin mo, eh ako sa pamilya ako galing eh. Di ba? Yung mga ganun. So, tingnan natin eh. Sabi ko, bakit ganun? Stressor sila. Because of the man. Totoo yung sinasabi ni Dr. Jerry. Kita ko yun kahapon at maggagawa pa kami ng mga ilan. So, nakakuha ko sa iyo, doktora, ng mga pwedeng sabihin natin sa kanila. No? Bakit ang tanong ko ngayon, bakit nag-iisip nilang magpakamatay? 'Yon. Bakit nila naiisip magpakamatay? Yung isang tama rin ang binanggit ng dalawa kanina, yung kasi may sinabi sila doon na isa sa nakakatanggal ng pagod nila at stress nila, nagdarasal sila. 'Yon. Nagdarasal. 'Yun lang ang daw ang kanilang way out kasi tinanong namin, sino ang nakakatulong sa inyo kapag kayo na stress? Wala daw. Misal, pag tumawag sila, masaya pamilya. Sabi nung isa, mama ko, pag nakikita ko yung mga resibo ko, kasi pinadala ko ng pera, yung mga resibo ko po, tutuwan ako. Kasi pag nagpadala ko ng resibo, pag nagpadala ko ng pera, wala nang sagot daw yung mga ganun klase. So, nakakalungkot na ang pamilya palang stressor. So, ngayon, sa iyong dalawa po, ano yung masabi niyo sa mga nagpapakamatay talaga na yan? At paano natin sila maawat, di ba? Kasi yung 10 na yun, parang nagulat ako. Maiyak-iyak talaga sila nagsasalita. Yung isang nasa Saudi, time na nagkoconduct kami ng focus group discussion, sumabay po siya. At sabi niya noon, masaya po ako dito. Wala po masyadong stress, walang problema. Tapos nung ginaganon-ganon mo na, yung parang iniikot mo, tinatanong mo ng pilit, aba, umiyak bigla. Kung meron lang po ako magagawa, hindi po sana ako magtatrabaho dito, et cetera, et cetera. Kaya lang wala po ako magawa. Tapos umiyak ng bigla. Ang pag-iyak din ba, isang pag-alis ng stress? Yun yung mga gusto kong sabihin eh. Oh, maraming salamat po sa inyo at marami po ako natutunan. Kasi ako din nagbibigay ng ganito. Ang inaano ko lang, yung tama, yung inhale, exhale, ginaganong ko yan, yung mga ganyan. Pero may nadagdag sa akin yung sinasabi ni Ma'am ano, Dr. Rapaz. Thank you po for that. Sana masagot niyo yung tanong ko, bakit nagpapakamatay sila? Yung mga ganun. Thank you po. Thank you.
Thank you po for your mga ano insights. Very ang dami. At least, ano, and very timing din, timely din sa mga ating bumabalik at saka nandun na OFW. So, Doc Paz, Doc J, any comments?
Okay. Thank you for sharing that. Doc J, may I go ahead? And you can, are we good? Yeah.
Yes, take it away.
Yeah, because sometimes, no, pag inaano yan, they want to escape, di ba? Escape na nila, parang, can I just, I mean, ayaw ko nang iiyak pa, pagod na ako. And maybe the only way that they could find is just, kung pwede nga lang maswalo na ako ng earth, sige na, di ba? And that's a way of escape. But sometimes, kaya kung minsan, no, it's good, no? Because we also had training before, di ba, Ma'am Mel, and solution-focused therapy and all. So it's good when they talk about that, let them talk about it. Oh, bakit? Bakit naisip mo na gusto mo nang namata? Ano bang nangyayari? So that they will also feel validated. Ma-validate sila, and when they talk about it, nailalabas nila yung painful emotion. So, it's good kasi sometimes na we learn na when somebody talks about magpakamatay, sabi natin, ay naku, wag yan, masama yan. So hindi na natin binavalidate. Importante, oh, ba't ganyan ang naisip mo? Di ba? Bakit wala na bang hope? So that when they talk, no, you are also there to say the, to show them na, oh, pwede pa naman itong gawin, itry mo to, etc. Mag-relax ka pa. And then maybe, no, when they are able to hear that, medyo ma-feel nila, oo nga pala, no? May ibang perspective, no? And maybe they would think of like, yes, I'm capable of going through it. So, importante ho doon, huwag tayong mag-nervyos kung magsabi nila, gusto ko nang magpakamatay. Oh, bakit ganun? Ikwento mo nga sa akin. So, parang relax din tayo, di ba? Then later on, naka-red flag na yan, ma-monitor na every now and then, alam mo na kung sinong pina-follow up mo. So, maybe Sir Jack can add more to it from your clinical perspective, di ba? Kasi ito parang napunta na sa high end, di ba? Sa end na talaga, no? When if possible, sana hindi sila mapapunta doon. Okay, so maybe that's my take. And thank you for sharing, Ma'am Fe. Yes, Sir Jer.
Okay, maganda yung sinabi ni Ma'am Fe, no? That's a very good observation on your end when you are talking with the other OFW. That is actually a very complicated, complex question. Why did I say this? Because some individuals may already what we call mental health conditions that may not be obvious to regular individuals who may not be trained, especially when it comes to MHPSS, okay, or clinical aspect of identifying. Actually, this is a point wherein you can already assist the individual how dangerous is her plan to end her life. The more she describes to you the clarity of her intention, the more serious and severe the plan is, and it has to be referred right away to a professional. Okay? You need to refer the Filipino migrant worker to a psychologist in the area or to a psychiatrist, no? Because that cannot be helped anymore by simply conversing with her. If it is simply some matters of letting go, so perhaps that can be addressed by the emotion-focused approaches. But if it is something deeper, then I think we need to intervene by referring, and the intervention is medical, so wala tayong magawa dyan. So that person has to be medicated. Now, ito ang kaya may training din yan eh. May MFA at may PFA. No? May psychological first aid at may mental first aid. No? So even if you are not a psychologist, by just observing, you can already identify and you can discriminate which of these people needs more assistance than the rest. No? Kasi sabi mo nga nang binabaliskad-baliskad mo na, lalong lumalabas. No? So doon mo na makita, ay hindi lang pala ito something very surface level. This is really deeper. Yan. That is already a clinical observation that the person needs more assistance. So what kind of assistance can I give? So ito ngayon ang MFA mo, ang mental health first aid. However, so in her case, then that is also true what Dr. Paz mentioned about being validated. Kasi minsan, like what I said earlier, the family back home only needs that you send money. So, pag nagpadala ka, for them, that's enough. Para milking cow ka lang. They don't even think of your welfare, na hirap, na nagpuyat ka, nagtrabaho. They don't even mention that. Ang i-mention lang nila is the gift. They forget the giver. That dapat isipin nila, when we receive this gift, sino ang giver? Anong ginawa niya para sa at? Anong sacrifice niya? Ano ang mga iniwanan niya that she has to do this? So most of the time, we are just focused on the gift. Kaya pag hindi pa tayo satisfied, sabihin mo pa, ay ano lang ba ito, kulang? Gusto ko mas advanced na cellphone. Ah, gusto ko mas ganitong gift. But they forgot na tatlong buwan yan na trabaho ang equivalent ng gift na yan. But we never even mentioned thank you. So kaya this is exactly what the feeling of the migrant worker in a destination country. So your family can either be your strength and at the same time can be your weakness, because if you don't see that you are loved and that you are also supported and appreciated, you will really feel na ano ba sila, ano ba pakiramdam nila sa akin dito, gatasan lang,
ano
pinipila lang ang pera dito. So kaya sometimes the family back home should also understand. Okay lang yan if you have your family there in the destination country. But if they're here, sometimes they just look at, lalo na sa Christmas ngayon, ang tinitingnan lang nila yung balikbayan box. Pag kulang yung binadal, ay, ano ba yan? Akala kong yaman kasi nag-abroad lang. They expect more from you when in fact, that is the opposite. No? You have to exert more time and only to realize sometimes buhay mo na lang ang kulang pala. Dugo na lang ang kulang na ipalabas mo to make them realize nga this is how difficult it is to be working in a far country. So, kung sa tingin natin na it is just what they need na to have somebody to listen to them, then provide that safe space. You are there, okay? Kung sa tingin ko nga pag just letting her express, no, parang kwan lang ang out kung sa Mayon volcano pa may outlet, no, so just let out the steam, then that will be the best. Pero minsan hindi lang outlet eh, talaga kailangan ng may mga conditions na they need more than just simply an outlet. So they need medication and professional help, and so that's where our help ends. That's where the professional help starts to be helpful. So, kaya may extra training pa dyan para you will be able to really say, I am able to help my fellow kababayan in the destination country. So, yun nga ang atin na dapat tingnan palagi, no? At both ends of the spectrum. That she simply needs simply an outlet where there is a safe space for her, or does she needs more than simply a safe space, but a medical intervention. So doon na Mang Fe, Miss Fe, papasok ang kwan mo, ang wisdom mo, ang experience mo to reach out to your fellow kababayan. Thank you.
Gusto ko lang sigurong idagdag din, no? Sa next Friday, yung webinar natin is on caring for caregivers in the context of the family. So siguro, if they are available, I think this will also help, no? Kasi yun nga, they're considered as caregivers, di ba? Siyempre, they have to care for themselves then. Katulad nung nabanggit, yung mga family back home, minsan di nila naiintindihan eh, di ba? Parang yung gift lang, katulad nung nabanggit ni Dr. J. They only are concerned about the gift but not the giver, no? So, at the same time, yung mga leaders natin dun, Fe, sa December kasi yung webinars natin are for parang trainers training. So, maybe kung may mga leaders tayo doon, no, na pwedeng sumali, Oo. Let us know so we can send them invitations also para maka-join din sila, no?
Well,
yes, sorry.
Thank you ha. Napakinggan ko na buong buo yung kila Jay at saka Kipas. Kuminsan kasi paalis-alis ako pero ngayon napakinggan ko na. And then of course the very useful insight ng ating mga participants, ano? Nabanggit natin yung family as a, you know, as a positive as well as a negative factor in the mental health of our OFWs, lalo na yung women migrant workers, lalo na sa mga nanay, because I think the stress is a lot more, no, kasi kasama emotional because of the lack of physical presence and yung care that is normally associated with being a mother. So, ang bigat nun sa nanay na hindi niya, she's caring for other kids, but yung mismo anak niya hindi niya maalagaan. That is the guilt part, no? Which is also adds up. Wala pa man yung mga stressor nandyan na yung, hindi pa siya nag-uumpisa, may stress na siya. Talking about the family, I think ang hindi rin natin, and in all of the studies, ano, point that out. Hindi na talagang proven na yan. Pero wala tayong masyadong intervention in also educating the family on how they can be, you know, be part of the problem but also part of the solution. Kasi in one study in Italy, for example, and I think this is true across all the countries, Hong Kong, EU, the US, ang level of indebtedness, no? Indebtedness ng ating mga OFW is such that baon na baon sa utang yung ating mga OFW because it's never enough, lalo na pag domestic work, ano? Hindi ganun kalaking kinikita nila as against the expectation, the demands of, lalo na pag young children, ano? About the, in the gifts, the balikbayan and all that. Hindi lang ang pamilya, kundi yung mga neighborhood, yung mga kaibigan and all that. So, ang laki talaga nun. And I think that it might be for us, think about the way we can reach out to family organizations of OFW, meron naman yata ganun, ano? To start thinking about how families can also help out and how they can be less of a problem, less of a psychological burden to our migrant workers. So yun ang tingin ko kasi meron na tayong seminar for officers, for POLOs, for DFA, for migrant workers. Pero yung pamilya, hindi natin na-interrogate. And I think it's about time we raise that serious issue. Kasi otherwise, talagang perpetually unstable ang ating mga domestic workers. And imagine the kind of burden that they are already carrying apart from earning a living, no? And the emotional and physical risk that they have to face. So yun lang. Let's think of a way our these kinds of webinars can also reach out to families of I think we can do that, Mel, kasi marami na tayo networks eh. Okay, yun lang. Thanks.
Thank you very much po, Ma'am Oye, for your insights. I think we would like to hear sana if and there are also insights from the other end of the ano. For example, from OWA, if meron kayong mga insights, OWA Singapore, do you have any insights regarding this one based on your experience with working and dealing with domestic workers? Anyone from OWA? Just in case, meron lang kayong gusto i-share.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon po sa inyong lahat.
Good afternoon.
Sa ngayon po, ano kasi eh, ang mga more on medical cases namin is yung more on cases namin is medical cases dito sa Singapore. So, meron man po mga ganyang mga cases. The last one is yung merong selective mutism. Working siya sa Singapore as nursing aide. Then, Andito na siya for almost 1 year. And then, basta isang araw na lang, hindi na siya nagsalita. So, akala nila is ayaw lang niya magsalita. And then later on, dinala siya sa IMH, meron siyang psychotic disorder and yun nga, selective mutism. Parang may nag-trigger yata sa kanya based on kwento ng employer niya, meron nag-trigger sa kanya para dun sa trauma niya. So, hanggang, naka-uwi na siya, actually, naka-uwi na siya nung 10. Kaya lang yun nga, halos isang linggo rin siyang napunta sa IMH for observation and chinek din siya ng ano. Siguro, sobrang stress po siguro.
Yun. So, those are certain some of the cases then. Opo.
Hi.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, may I add? Oh, sorry, I wasn't able to open my cam because I was on the phone. I'm Marivi Clarine. I'm with Awa Manila. I've met Ms. Nuke before. Ang karamihan pang cases, in addition to what Nina mentioned kanina, dito yung because of pressure from work, so nadidepress. So ang leading noon, there were cases sa amin ng this year, I'm not sure if it's 3 or 4, pressure from work usually, kasi ang Singaporean, di ba, gusto nila makuha to the last centavo na binayad sa'yo, sulitin yung sweldo mo. So may mga attempted suicide, at yung iba talaga nag-suicide. There's this one lang na dalawa na hindi siya natuloy. I mean, buhay sila until now, but may attempt sila. So although merong dalawa na because of pressure from work, nagkaroon talaga. And there's this one also pressure din from family. So yung gastusan, di ba, pareho nang nabanggit kanina, karamihan yung mga panggastos dyan pang araw-araw sa Pilipinas ng kanya-kanyang families ay kumbaga nakasalalay sa pinadadala ng mga workers. So yun yung ibang ano namin, nagli-lead talaga sa suicide cases. And that's very ano, kumbaga medyo alarming, di ba? Kasi hindi nila kayang i-handle eh. So yun yung ano. Right now, hindi ko pala, meron kanina nag-message sa akin, meron ding depression, but hindi ko pa siya nakakausap. I'm trying to ano, to get pa the name and the contact number. So usually, nagme-message sila sa aming hotline, kinakausap lang namin talaga paano sila, paano nila i-handle. We share kung anong mga naging experiences namin, cases na na-handle para at least panlaban sa kanila, pampalakas ng loob. Hindi kami talaga yung equipped ng totally, but we share based on our experiences. And ano naman po namin, mukhang ano naman, they listen. And may follow up kung sakali after a week or two, tinitingnan namin, kinukumusta namin kung ano na yung lagay. And pag may concerns naman, nagme-message po sila or tumatawag sa amin. Maraming ganyang cases, hindi lang ito domestic workers, no? Yung depression, madami ding ano ngayon sa mga professionals, even mga lalaki. Usually ang na-handle namin dati kasi nanggaling po ako ng Hong Kong, so babae itong karamihan. So, yun naman. But dito ho, may mga cases po kami ng lalaki. So yun po. Thank you.
Thank you very, thank you po, ma'am. So, yun. So yun yung mga ibang cases. So, yung sa, I remember kay Miss, ano, Miss Sunga po, yung sa Cyprus. Do you have any experience ng Filipino community naman dyan? Ano yung mga usual cases po sa Cyprus?
Yan. Good morning po mula sa Cyprus. So ang karamihan pong cases namin din ay yung marami po kinidiling mga Pilipinang may sakit. So yung mga cancer survivors, marami po breast cancer din and pero ang problema po sa kanila, hindi makauwi kasi pag-uwi po, wala talaga. So yun nga po yung sinasabi nila, pumunta sila din sa Cyprus, sila yung walang pera. Ngayon po, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years na sila din sa Cyprus, uuwi pa rin po sila ng Pilipinas, walang-wala na. So nadoble na po yung pagkawalang pera. So yun po yung maraming kaso namin din. At saka yung mga labor issues po, mga labor cases, na may mga problema sa employers, gusto magpa-release, ayaw i-release ng employers. Meron pong mga gusto nang umuwi, ayaw hindi makauwi kasi hindi po handa. So ang ang OWA Greece po, kami po ay under ng OWA Greece, very attentive naman po si Well of Maribic Mondina, si trying accommodate all cases ng mga OFWs din eh. So tinutulungan ko po siya in that particular part ng kapag din na sa Cyprus. So minsan, nagtutulong kaming dalawa para ayusin yung problema ng OFWs din eh. Kasi noon pong during pandemic, ginawa po nila akong parang Cyprus coordinator. So tapos na po yun ngayon, pero ako po ay presidente ng isang organization din sa Cyprus na tinututukan po talaga yung mga problema ng mga OFWs. So yung mga tulad po nito, napakalaking tulong po ito yung natutunan ko ngayon kasi talagang meron din po din yung mga Pilipina na talagang problema po. Hindi po alam kung paano i-handle yung kanilang stress. So kung ano-ano na po yung mga ginagawa. Kaya po trying po na tinatry po namin na matulungan sila pag lumapit sa amin. So yung mga hindi po lumalapit, eh hindi po namin alam yung mga kaso. Pero marami po talaga. Talagang dapat pong matutukan ng OWA yung stress management na ito ng mga OFWs. Although, din po sa Cyprus, may project din ng European Union program for the migrants. So, meron part po ng kanilang project itong ang sa counseling kung yung mga may problema, paano nila i-handle. So, may mga training and practices po din silang ginagawa tulad ng engineer ni Dr. Paz. May mga ganun po kami din na practice. So, nagagamit po namin. So, yung mga ibang OFWs po kasi ayaw mag-attend ng mga trainings, ayaw mag-attend ng mga seminars. So, sila po yung karaniwang problema din ng mga, ng OWA. So, ganun po yung aming sitwasyon. Pero, we are trying to manage po how we can help each other na hindi na po lahat iaakyat sa gobyerno. Talagang hindi po kaya ng gobyerno. So, kami po mismo mga OFWs, at mga organization, tumutulong na sa kapwa namin OFW. So, ganun po yung aming sitwasyon din Salamat po. Napakaganda pong tulong itong inyong inorganize na ito kasi mas kami po yung nadagdagan yung aming kaalaman kung paano namin tutulungan pa yung aming kapwa OFW.
Thank you po. Very good sa mga insights. At least ang maganda dyan, nagtutulungan din kayo. Tutulungan yung community. Yung importante. Opo. Kasi mahirap yung palagi maasa lang palagi from one
hindi
point. So, which is very good.
Hindi po kaya. Opo.
So, any other questions? Actually, meron follow-up regarding daw sa outlets, di ba? Sabi, to relieve stress, there are certain outlets. Paano ko yung outlet na yon ay nakakasama na rin from their end? Kasi di ba, iba-ibang form of outlet to relieve stress. For example, iba, nag-yoyos, kumakain, o kaya nag-gamble. O, paano yung mga ganong, ano, kasi sasabi, ito yung aking form of release of my stress. Okay, bakit mo pa ako pipigilan? How do we resolve that situation naman ng ganong mind way of thinking?
Okay. Ang ganda yan talaga, no? I was expecting that kind of line of thinking. Actually, when we say you need to cope, it is a must to cope. Actually, even what they did is coping. Kaya lang, there is also another level of coping. There is what you call appropriate coping and inappropriate coping. So, stress eating is a coping. Kaya lang kung sobra naman, outside of moderation, lumalaki ka naman, lumulobo. So, it becomes detrimental to your health. What we are trying to address is it has to be a healthy coping. So in the case of that particular individual na sinabi, yung gambling, i-coping ko ito. Yes, coping mo nga, pero tingnan mo naman ang impact at epekto ng utang-utang ka na. So hindi na sa healthy for you. No? Healthy yan kung the benefits are really felt. Like hindi ka palagi natatalo. malaking pera binibalik mo. Pero kung nakita mo na nagka-utang-utang ka na, I remember there was a particular client of mine, ha? Pag pumunta sa casino, kotse lang ba lang ng tatay, binibenta niya kasi pag lumabas sa casino, akala niya babawi niya pa yung natalo niya. So, hindi sa lalabas pag hindi sa makabawi. So, minsan binibenta niya, sinasandla niya yung kotse na gin-drive niya. Pagka the next day, uuwi na lang siya, hindi pa nabawi yung kotse. Kaya nagulat ang tatay, saan ang kotse ko dito? Kasi isinandla niya pala sa casino. So yun ang tawag natin na in an appropriate or unhealthy na. Kasi it is not anymore helping. It becomes an addiction already. So it even aggravated the situation rather than help you. So it is another concern that you have to address. No? So it cannot be made an excuse that just because that is your coping, parang baliwala na sa'yo. Kahit alam mo nang inuuntog mo ng sarili mo, tatanungin mo, nakatulong ba yan ang pag-untog mo sa sarili mo o hindi? Ikaw rin makasagot niya. So kung ang sagot mo ay tama, well, tingnan natin kung pag-utang-utang mo, mababayaran mo pa, baka bandang huli, kakabulin ka na ng inatagan mo o ano pa ang gagawin sa'yo. So then you will realize, no? Kaya lang some Filipinos also learn the hard way until it hits them, no, at the end. So that is also a challenge, no, na kailangan we have to be very prudent and wise with the kind of coping. No, I think the best answer is moderation. In everything, there has to be moderation. Kaya nga ang timbangan, no? Ang tulog, healthy. Pero kung sobra ka naman ng tulog, minsan wala ka naman lakas o enerhiya to work, no? Ang inom, healthy din yan. Pero kung sobra ka naman inom, lasing ka, gumagapang ka na. Hindi naman. O minsan, dangerous pa mag-drive kasi driving in the spirit of alcohol can also lead you to death. So there is always moderation in everything that we do. So you have to find your own moderation because in every person, iba-iba ang kanyang moderating level. So in his on her case, what is moderation for you? Okay, so that is the bottom line of our coping.
Thank you po. So I think there are no more questions. I think we already went overboard sa time. So thank you very much for the ideas, for the insights, and for your comments at the same time, yung mga sharing of your stories, which is very helpful at this point. Now, may we call on back Mamel for our closing remarks.
Okay. Thank you, Lance. Oo. Maraming salamat. I think this is a very interesting webinar for all of us. Very good presentations by Dr. J and Dr. Paz. And then, of course, the sharing, no, sa ating mga OWA on the ground and si yung ating grupo sa Cyprus. So these are very important sharing, no, na kung saan nalalaman natin ang experiences nyo mismo on the ground. Maraming salamat. At in fact, I think ito yung reason kung bakit may mga follow-up trainings tayo in a partnership with the British Embassy Manila. Because we found out last year that our webinars were very much appreciated by the participants. And as I mentioned earlier, sa Friday, November 19, we'll have another webinar for webinar on caring for caregivers in the context of the family. Tapos sa 26, yung webinar on gender-based violence and migrants' rights. Sorry. At sa December naman, may trainers training tayo. Ito for polo welfare officers, DSWD, social welfare attaches, and other social workers. And of course, I think we also would like to welcome here yung ating mga leaders, no? Leaders ng ating mga communities. So, take note po itong mga to, but definitely we'll be sending you invitations, no? So, thank you very much. And we hope that I will be sending the presentations of both Dr. J and Dr. Paz para po ma-remind tayo. And let's always remember yung 3 minutes or 5 minutes. And then if we can increase it to a few more minutes, so we can also relax ourselves. And definitely in the next webinars, we'll learn more, no, about how to care for ourselves, how to care for others. So thank you very much po for your active participation. And see you again on Friday and the next webinars.